So where are we even here?
Okay, ladies and gentlemen, a warm welcome to Ambassador Laura Kennedy, and thank you very much for making the time available. Before we start officially, I think it's a good idea to just go and grab something to eat.
Okay.
And have a go at the food, and then we start.
Okay, great. That's, so we'll eat right
we'll
here.
We'll eat here, yes.
Great. Okay.
So please.
Oh my God.
It was great to, then I went to this
Her talk is Women in Nuclear in New York and Vienna, so we are very curious to hear what she has to say. Before I give the floor to you, Laura, let me just quickly introduce her to you. So you've read her bio in the invitation. I'm not going to go through all the details, but Laura has been in the diplomatic path for many, many, many years. She's been to most of the world. In Vienna as well, and I think it is your second time of coming back to Vienna. Third time, okay. I've just had the pleasure to have a conversation with her about some of the experiences which she has shared with me. And I would like to appreciate Debbie in facilitating this event, which is very much appreciated. Laura, it's a great honor and pleasure, and please, go ahead.
Okay, well, you know, thank you. One, thank you so much, Debbie, for inviting me here. I've wanted to do this for a long time. Now, to me, it's more comfortable and more informal to say that than to sit down. But if you can't hear me, I'll stand up. So just let me know if I'm not coming across. If that's an audible way, maybe then what I'm saying doesn't make sense, whatever the acoustics are. But that's a different issue. But again, we just been talking a bit about things that I've actually, and again, congratulations, 17 years in business, which actually, 1998, when I know you were founded, was the first time I came to work with the IAEA. When I was here before, I started off working on conventional arms control before I moved into the exciting world of nuclear in 98. But I think it's, again, thanks to organizations like you that, that have helped bring about the big changes I see since I've come back last year to serve again here at Envy. But I think that, okay, some things are familiar. For example, when I was here in 1998, we had fabulous women working on our team and at the agency. I mean, Lisa Hilliard was part of our team. Janice was at the NRC at that time and already making her her mark. Laura Rockwood was in legal there, who, by the way, as you may know, and I'm here, want to get her back to speak, has just come back to Vienna to head the Vienna Center, which is a big platform for all things nuclear here in Vienna. Jill Cooley was an old friend, but coming back, I'm delighted, of course, to see that she's being succeeded by another great female professional. A huge change I've seen since 98 is the growth in the ranks of female ambassadors here. There's actually sort of an informal association. We get together periodically for events. When I was here before, I remember one female governor, the French ambassador, you remember her. And now there is, you know, to steal an old nuclear cliche, definitely reached a critical mass. We have an extraordinary team of female professionals at our team in Envy here today. I'm thrilled some of us are here today. Erica Augustenborg, Erola, and let's see, Dylan is our, you know, has facilitated this. Thank you, Dylan, for joining us here today. Andrea, just we have two, like Andrea from the Department of Energy, also Casey Deering. We have the NRC's only serving overseas official, Cindy Jones. Did I miss anybody? Oh, and from Brooke, and of course we did have, actually, when I was here before, from a representative from Brookhaven National Labs, Barbara Hoffheinz, whom you all may know. Also, delighted, where's my colleague from CTBT? Ah, okay. The head of our Arms Patrol section, which covers CTBTO, Tammy Fitzgerald. So we have great representation of women here. We were just talking about the Iran talks. Of course, you all know our Undersecretary Wendy Sherman has led that for years. Another of our undersecretaries, who's been my boss for many years in the past, Rose Gadamer. Again, lifelong career professional in the nuclear field. So we have extraordinary talent. I'm thrilled, of course, to come back this time and to see Janice Dudley again as the DDG for management here. Let me just, again, no surprise to anybody here, but pay tribute to all the great work that Janice has done. Not just at the agency in terms of gender equality, but the work that I know she's done in terms of encouraging women and girls to join the STEM field. And we were really pleased to see this practical agreement, or whatever it's called, that was signed with the Nuclear Power Institute of Texas A&M, again, to work in this area. Matter of fact, and they really are active. I was in an IAEA-related trip in Southeast Asia, and I ran into Texas A&M in Jakarta, just by chance, working again on this area. How do you get good representation, equal representation, or at least equal representation in the STEM field? So, you know, I've been a lifelong feminist, so this is personally gratifying to me, but basically, it's such an honor for me as an American to represent an administration that is committed to gender equality at home and abroad. We are strong and enthusiastic supporters of the UN Women Office and all of their activities. As you all probably know, we actively track the employment of women at the agency. Now, correct me if I'm wrong, I mean, because, you know, these change back and forth, and, you know, there's probably always some room for how you actually define it, but professionally, we come out at about 28% overall for women professionals in the agency. Lots of scope for Janice's continued good work. The DG's office, although I think it's, you know, 50% female, is, you know, that's by at least one calculation, his office. So I don't know if probably, again, probably depends on how you measure it. But management and TC, we kind of is that 40%. So again, that is the best record in the agency. So that, again, always room for improvement. CTBTO, we get about 34% of the provisional technical secretary we count as professional women. But again, starting at the beginning is crucial. CFEs, junior professional folks, a great way to start the agency. I mean, get another great woman, the agency, Perry Lynn Johnson, started as a junior professional in another UN agency. So that's a great program. Okay, but you probably know all these statistics far better than I do, and so I was hoping we could sort of talk and, you know, hear your questions and comments about, you know, a lot of the issues that you face here. I was told that the people might be interested in the Non-Proliferation Treaty Review Conference. I've just spent a month there, so I'm glad to talk a little bit about that. Again, just given our theme today, in terms of at least my theme, I would note a couple things. We did have a female president of the conference, another Vienna alum, Algeria's ambassador Taos Farouki, who served here for over a decade, not so long ago. This was the second time, however, a review conference has had a female president. We had a Swedish president back in, what year was that? I think it was 1985. But Bob Einhorn tells great stories about her, you know, boy, her incredible way of managing that conference. However, I note that none of the committee chairs, either main committees or subsidiary bodies, were female. So no progress there, frankly, because these are all key players at this review conference. Now, in terms of actually the substance, I don't know if anybody's plowed through the draft document, which was not adopted, and I can get to that. We were one of the ones who did not join consensus on that document, but still, it's an important document. It's a barometer of where we are. It represents a month's worth of solid discussions, and I do note that they did have a line in the conference. Make sure I get this right. The conference emphasizes the importance of ensuring the equal participation of both women and men in the process of nuclear non-proliferation, nuclear disarmament, and the peaceful use of nuclear energy. Language we were happy to support. I'm not sure on whose initiative this was put forward, but you know, I think you see this in many things. Certainly the sentiment is one that we wholeheartedly endorse, although, you know, it says ensuring equal participation. Not quite sure what that means, because speaking as an American official, we don't support quotas. I mean, it's inconsistent with our Constitution. But in terms of being an inclusive process, that obviously, both in terms of actors and beneficiaries of IAEA programs, obviously, gender balance as well as diversity across the board is certainly a source of strength. I'd actually just been talking a little bit here about that review conference. As I say, we did not come up with a consensus final document. We were, as I say, one of three that didn't join a consensus. It was over one specific issue. Although we came to that conference working towards a consensus outcome, we never defined the outcome of a conference with producing a final document. For example, this is the third review conference that has not produced one. That said, it was a disappointment. We were more than willing to join consensus on the document that covered all three pillars of the NPT treaty. The problem was, as is often the case in this very complicated history, the Middle East. We have worked as one of the three depositaries of the Non-Proliferation Treaty itself. We had a specific role to try and bring about a conference on establishing a zone free of weapons of mass destruction in the Middle East. We have worked like dogs on that. Not me personally. I'm sort of on the outside run of that, but our Assistant Secretary Tom Countryman has devoted no more time, more time to this issue than any other. Up until, frankly, the last minute, we were hoping that we could come up with something that would truly lead to what you need to have a conference like this, and that is a process that's consensus-based, that's inclusive, and that means, for example, Israel, which is not an NPT party, but a zone, is not actually, you know, you can establish a zone under anyone's auspices. You don't need the NPT. But if you're going to have a regional weapons-free zone, according to the UN's own guidelines, you have to have all the participants of the region, which means you have to be able to create the conditions that would allow Israel to join. We did not feel that it did that, and because we're so committed to this process, we couldn't cynically sign on to something that we thought would be guaranteed not to lead to that outcome. That said, no outcome document, but we think, and all this stuff is online, the UN Office of UN website, the Office of Disarmament Affairs, ODA, which, by the way, up until this month was headed by another great woman, Angela Kane, who's been to Vienna many times. Anyhow, so all those documents are on the website. What I think is broadly speaking, and I can sort of go through chapter and verse on all the text, but I don't think we have time or necessarily this is the place to do it. But what I wanted to emphasize was that if you go through the text, you will see that the role of the agency is underlined and as essential to the this treaty, which again we continue to see as the architecture governing the global non-proliferation regime. So that's the good news. I mean, the agency, I think certainly in the view of our government, gets very high marks. And again, thank you, Janice. Thank you to all of you folks who work at the agency. The CTBT, by the way, if you look at the text, you compare it to 2010, these are every five-year documents, expanded treatment of the CTBT. People were delighted that, for example, Masina Zerbal was given a sort of prime speaking slot and moved up in the order of things in recognition of the important work you do here in Vienna. Aside from actual text, as I say, there was an outcome document, but it's a useful sort of summation of the work we did. This conference means a lot, achieved a lot. For example, it brings together people from around the world, the global community. The side events, frankly, I think are as valuable as anything that goes on in the plenary floor. The agency had side events for every single one of the topics under consideration. They were great. NGO, and this is something that both non-governmental organizations and governments work together in terms of putting on these things. Again, covering all the different aspects of nuclear. Really, really fantastic. It's also a great opportunity to raise money for the agency. For additional voluntary uses. The Peaceful Uses Initiative was kicked off in 2010. I was thrilled when another great woman in nuclear, Hillary Clinton, as our Secretary of State, announced $50 million for peaceful uses. And then, Dylan, we ran up to under the first tranche from 2010, what did you say, about $77 million under that?
$77
million
total.
Yeah. So we had a new burst of fundraising, again, centered on the review conference. We're basically about $80 million. Right now, the U.S. announced another $50 million. Japan kicked in $25 million. Republic of Korea, $1 million. Israel, for the first time, has donated, although not in the context, obviously, the review conference. They're not an NPT member, but I think, the fact that they, And by the way, Israel participated as an observer at this review conference for the first time in 20 years. So that gave an interesting new dynamic to the conference as well. Others as well, Australia, Canada, Germany. So, some of these pledges are still sort of in the works. I know that the DG has worked hard on China. We're still waiting for those numbers. So again, it provides an opportunity to galvanize the community. And we all know how budgets are strained at the agency. They are, of course, everywhere. So this is obviously does not substitute for the regular budget, but it gives additional flexibility to the agency to fund many programs that would otherwise have to go unfunded. So I, again, think that's one of the important things that the conference does. Oh, in addition to peaceful uses, specifically focus on, I don't know if anybody here is working directly with the labs, the renewal project for the refurbishment of the labs. We gave a new $2 million. Japan gave another $2 million. Others are kicking in. So it's a shot in the arm for that extremely important project. I was saying, I just looked in your website and I saw the reference to the conference in August. One of the things I think is interesting for those of you folks who may work in technical cooperation, nuclear applications, you know, the DG is talking now increasingly about atoms for peace and development. And that was something else, by the way, that the review conference captured, and that is the extent to which nuclear feeds into, you know, the whole UN, what we call the post-2015, you know, Millennium Development Goals. So I think this, again, was a step forward for nuclear in terms of getting a worldwide recognition for the role that nuclear can play beyond the power industry, which most people, you know, continue to associate nuclear with, which of course is vitally important. But nuclear applications is a story that increasingly, I think, is being told, despite the fact that obviously there are setbacks. Fukushima, of course, was a focus of the review conference. Some of the good things that came out here, for anybody here who works in nuclear safety, increased focus on nuclear safety. And that probably wouldn't surprise people because, of course, Fukushima has been a big driver. We had a big conference on nuclear safety in Vienna last February. So that was probably maybe one could say a no-brainer. But the way it's captured, the way it's laid out is still important. Another one, I think, talked to several folks here who were working in nuclear security. That's one of the things we thought was a good thing. Expanded treatment of nuclear security, recognition of the important role that it plays. Disarmament, by the way, was another very contentious area of the review conference. I worked, by the way, specifically on Pillar 2, not the non-proliferation section, you know, because they, you know, you actually divide into different committees, and we all stay in touch, but it's amazing, given the pace of work, there is a little bit of stovepiping. So I was doing non-proliferation. Nuclear disarmament, though, was a huge focus of I'd say, the a lot of the politics, because there's quite a divide about the way forward on nuclear disarmament. That's the first pillar, which I did in 2010, and so believe me, I was happy to work on nuclear non-proliferation this time around. And, of course, the third pillar, peaceful uses, where, for example, I was talking about the expanded treatment of safety issues was in pillar three. As I say, we didn't have this final outcome, but we don't see this as something that occurs once every 5 years, this month-long review conference, and you pack your bags and go home. Because of the importance of the issues that you work on every day, we see the NPT as basically a 365 days a year treaty. The IAEA, which is, you know, the driving engine, the platform, I don't know, whatever the best way to put it, Janice will come up with something better than that. But so the work goes on, and after all, we have in the here in Vienna, the policy-making organs, the General Conference, you know, which has resolutions covering all of these issues that we work out every, largely on a consensus basis. Part of the problem is that people, and the reason I think there's a lot of frustration on the disarmament side, I spent 3 years in Geneva at the Conference on Disarmament, and many people describe that institution as broken. That is probably maybe a little unfair, but the fact of the matter is it has not actually negotiated a new instrument since 1996. So obviously frustration levels have risen. Now, however, when you look at the other two pillars of the treaty, non-proliferation peaceful uses, yes, there's difference of opinion on maybe additional protocol or you know, export controls and this, that, and the other. And those are real. But we have the machinery in place, both in a policy-making sense of the, you know, for the member states, and the implementers, you, It's not broke. It's thriving. And as I say, this review conference endorsed and recognized how vital the work of the agency is. So that part is fully on track. But the disarmament side of the house was also a very difficult conversation. And the Middle East, as I say, it's really its own sort of issue there that's always very difficult and very problematic. So as I say, maybe I'm just a naive optimist. I think you always have to try and be optimistic, you know, or you wouldn't have picked diplomacy as a profession.
Believe me.
So maybe I'm a little too Pollyanna-ish. So much as we regret not having an outcome document, IAEA is alive and well. I think this treaty is not just alive and kicking, but especially on non-proliferation and peaceful using, getting more and more important and vital every day. Now, of course, how do you pay for that? As Janice knows, this is probably the most difficult issue of everything that you do. As I say, the review conference helps to generate additional funds for the agency. Also, I'm delighted that, again, if you want to pick out another woman in nuclear, the Norwegian ambassador, Bente Hansen, was the co-chair of a new group, you know, to develop guidelines for resource mobilization. Because again, needs are so huge, and they're expanding all the time. I mean, the desire for nuclear applications around the world is just extraordinary. The power industry, whether, you know, new nuclear plants are open, and there's a number, of course, that are in train, whether that's, you know, hundreds or dozens, the fact of the matter is that we all know, once you decommission, that material stays under safeguards. So the burdens on the agency on safeguards alone are huge. We won't even start on the uranium program, assuming we get a deal. So if we can get more creative about tapping, you know, developing these private partnerships, maybe that can help. Just we were talking about the nuclear threat initiative earlier, and you know, Warren Buffett, who donated so much money there. But basically, it all comes down to people. They conceive these programs, they implement them, and half the beneficiaries, ideally, or at least women. So it's really basically you folks and organizations like this that are central to the health of the agency. And God bless you all. And thank you for giving me a soapbox to talk about this work. I really appreciate having the opportunity to come. And I'm thrilled to hear about the conference in August. I'm just thrilled to hear your comments, questions. If I don't hear from you, I'll ask you some questions. So you're not off the hook.
So I have a comment.
Great.
I actually have an appreciation. I do a lot of the work for TC Africa in access to healthcare. And if it wasn't for the peaceful use initiatives, we would not be as far along in non-communicable diseases.
Oh, yeah.
We get a lot of resources for communicable diseases, but some of the number one killers are cancer in our cities. So we're able to put that money to use to train people and get the appropriate equipment in there to safely use it for medical indications. So I appreciate your efforts and hope they continue on.
Well, it's thanks go to the American taxpayer, I guess. But on the other hand, we do help, obviously, you know, sort of help the government, you know, allocate those money. Dylan Fisher has been a tireless advocate for all of these programs. I must say that Africa in particular is something that we're very much focused on. If you ever look at the statistics, and I do not have these in my head, but I've seen them before, and they are really shocking. Access to medical isotopes is so, if you just take that one metric, Africa is so underserved there as a continent. It has got to be a focus here. Now, this is folks who work in nuclear security, you know, this is why it's so important to have an agency like WiN-IAEA, they can integrate all these different things because how, you know, we want to increase the access to medical isotopes in the production. We want to do it in a safe and secure way, though, which means, for example, in our view, how do we do it so we minimize the use of highly enriched uranium? But anyhow, that's great. And of course, you have an alum from the TC Africa program, right, heading the Mr. Lee, who takes over, I guess, in
Young.
Oh my God. Okay. Anyhow, but by the way, when you mentioned cancer, Kwakulani, in particular, deserves so much credit for the work he's done in that area. That's something he and I share with both cancer, survivors or whatever. And so he's got, you know, a professional and a personal, I think, commitment there to enhance some access. And again, something I think the agency has done great work on. So, thank you.
So, Kennedy, thank you very much for your interesting inside view of the NPT conference. I work in the direct implementation of the non-proliferation part. And you know, in the NPT, it is enshrined that any non-nuclear weapon state that joins the NPT has to fulfill the safeguards agreement and put all its nuclear material under agency safeguards. Such a provision does not exist for the nuclear weapon states. This provision about nuclear disarmament is rather, how should I call it, not very clearly defined. And there is no authority in charge of the nuclear disarmament. Not like the agency, they didn't put the agency in charge of nuclear. Do you think that that is the reason why there has not been much progress on the disarmament front? Of what do you think is the reason?
Well, you know, when the treaty was written years ago, Article 6, if you look at Article 6, which governs nuclear disarmament, is a very broad general provision. It doesn't set timelines. It doesn't specify, as
at
you say, mechanisms. It just says, it actually, interestingly, and this isn't something that we in any way underline or emphasize, but it actually talks about nuclear disarmament, the commitment to, achieve nuclear disarmament. The treaty says, in conditions of general and complete disarmament. So if you read that literally, you could read that to mean like, we're going to get down to zero nuclear weapons when we've gotten rid of all the other weapons. That's actually one way to interpret. We don't. We say that we want, we want the peace and security of the world without nuclear weapons, period. But the fact of the matter is that 90% of the nuclear arsenal is still in U.S. and Russian hands. This has been the way to get and because it's a reciprocal process, it means that nobody is more tough on verification, for example, than the other party. So one of the challenges will be, how do you move from that bilateral paradigm to a multilateral world? And that's one of the things actually we are working on, because the IAEA, as Lisa will remember from like the trilateral edition and stuff, in terms of disarmament, it has to be asked. It's not tasked with a disarmament function. It's available if the sort of like, it's approved. But we are starting to work on, and a number of states already have been, we've come up with something called the International Partnership, for example, that's going to look at how do you develop on a cooperative basis non-nuclear weapon states and nuclear weapon states, the verification techniques and approaches, that we need when we get to a multilateral framework. But for now, as I say, with two countries responsible for virtually all of it, this is we believe, the way to go in terms of dealing most directly with bringing those numbers out, which is why from 2013 we put out a proposal for one-third cuts, bringing it, the next big step down to Russia, and so far we have not gotten them to come to the table. But there are all sorts of collective, CTBT, which you can say is both disarmament and non-proliferation. We still have to get that ratified, for example, the U.S. and a number of other states. Again, something we're working very hard at to get those 67 votes out of 100 in our Senate to ratify. But there's all sorts of actually disarmament measures that can be taken in a range of different ways. Conference on Disarmament, which as I say has been sort of stuck because one state has not been willing to start what we see as the next step on the way down to zero, which is to cut off legally fissile material production for nuclear weapons, because this is basically, this is what makes nuclear weapons. So there's a whole bunch of different ways to pursue disarmament that are being pursued. I would invite you, if you say like, oh, nothing's happened to disarmament, every single day, we are dismantling and disposing of appropriately our nuclear stockpile. So if people say, oh, nothing's happening, it is every single day, but it has to be done safely, securely, and so on, because you can imagine, we're talking about the pits of nuclear weapons. So this work actually is going on, and I would actually invite you, at least I can only speak for the U.S., not other nuclear weapon states, go online, you can look under NPT, you can look under Office of Disarmament Affairs, and we submit, every year, reports on what we're doing on disarmament. We do hundreds of pages long, and it details all the things we're doing. And actually, under the NPT, the other nuclear weapon states reported to the NPT about steps they're taking. Frankly, nobody came close to us in terms of the detail and the transparency of this. But we do detail this, it's public, so you can go online. So I actually would encourage you to look at that, because it details all the different things we are to bring our arsenal down to zero. It's a slow, painful process. Yes, everyone is frustrated that it is not going fast, and we absolutely share that that frustration. But frustration is not a policy, so we're actually working on every front we can to see where to make progress unilaterally, multilaterally, and bilaterally.
Laura, okay, easy question. Who are the other two that opposed or didn't reach, couldn't join consensus?
Okay, it was our other co-depositary for the NPT, the United Kingdom. There's three depositaries in the treaty, the US, the UK, and Russia. Now, Russia, however, actually put out its own proposal on the Middle East, which we, on their own, which we sought to sort of, again, try and get into a direction that we could support. There were various drafts of this put out. Okay, the UK, which felt very strongly as we did, and was directly involved in this whole Middle East thing. Canada, which is not a depositary, has not been directly involved in these talks, but feels very strongly about the way to move forward in the Middle East. So these were three that specifically on the Middle East didn't join consensus. Now, frankly, there are a lot of other countries that might not have joined a consensus over the disarmament section. Some people felt, on both ends of the spectrums, some people felt that it framed the debate in an unacceptable way. Other people didn't like it because they thought it didn't mandate enough steps. So on both sides, it was a somewhat polarized debate on the disarmament side. But it simply didn't come to that stage because the Middle East became the focus and we made clear that we couldn't sign on. But as I say, heading to that issue, disarmament, conceivably, this is purely hypothetical, might have led to some countries not signing on as well.
And so, kind of following on, what do you anticipate for the general conference coming up? I mean, what's the thinking? What kind of dialogue are we going to be hearing?
Well, that's the key question. And it was interesting, this last board was could have been a bit of a barometer.
Right.
Although they're supposed to be, I guess, sort of closed meetings. I won't talk about that, I guess, so much. Although, by the way, and I don't mean to come across as a propagandist, but just sort of if you want additional tools, I have little cards with our websites because you can read all my statements on the war in which I do talk about. So if you're interested, there they are. Plus I tweet. I made a specific statement about the review conference and the Middle East issue. general conference a little early yet, except for, yikes, and this I'm sure is out on it, because I did comment on it, because I can say what I say, but I'm not, according to the rules, I'm not supposed to quote from other states, so I won't, but I did comment in my statement about the fact that states have already sort of thrown on the gauntlet and said they will pursue a resolution singling out Israel, which we will oppose, assuming they do that. Obviously, it's really important if we can pursue a path that's constructive, which is certainly, right smack in the middle of our belief. Because if indeed one of these resolutions is pursued, it's going to be, drive the parties further apart. So I hope that they don't pursue it. If they do, we're going to have to gear up and defeat it again. And that, I think, will sort of retard prospects for getting back on a constructive path. So that's something, obviously, we're concerned about now. Whether it spills over into other areas, as we have, generally our resolutions are consensus. And they're important resolutions. They're much more detailed than, for example, the documents that come out of the review conference, generally, much more detailed. But there's other issues besides the Middle East that are obviously difficult points. I mean, again, if you read my statements, you'll see, for example, and I know you worked on the same parts of implementation report, Ukraine has been a real issue there. So whether Russia, this is no surprise, I'm not betraying anybody's confidence here, if Russia pursues this aggressive path in terms of seeking to force the agency to recognize their control, in a legal sense, their control over nuclear facilities in Ukraine, which is recognized by nobody but Russia, so one hopes that they will not push this to the GC, but it's just something else that's out there. There's probably a load of other issues that you guys probably know in detail more than I do. I hope it doesn't, because this is, as a very, very key body for the year. We should say. By the way, we'll start off with a new chair of the Board of Governors, a very important job held by a woman this past year, Marta Ziakova of Slovakia, who is there in the nuclear regulatory field, their chief regulator. She'll be handing off to an excellent choice, not a female, but that's okay. We still will have to identify a president of the General Conference. It actually was a female governor, my first General Conference in 1998. We'll see, maybe we'll have a good woman to run the General Conference and make sure that all goes well. But yeah, I think it'll be perhaps more difficult than usual General Conference. They all have their own dynamic. Yes. When I was talking about peaceful uses and how strongly we support the Director General's peaceful uses initiative, because again, and we're proud of our record of support to the Technical Cooperation Fund, the largest single donor, we're proud of that. But again, peaceful uses initiative gives the agency more flexibility, allows them to finance projects that otherwise would be unfunded. So, and when I talked about growing appreciation for peaceful uses and nuclear applications, we developed actually an app. And I'm like sort of 20th century, but I'm trying to get 21st century. So Dylan worked hard on this. It's a great product. It's called Amazing App. Is it singular or plural? Adam or Adams?
Amazing Adams.
Amazing Adams. So I have an app. app. You can download it, and it shows sort of color coded for, you know, whether it's nuclear, whether it's health, agriculture, or environment, or nuclear power, and it sort of like highlights. You know, different projects around the world in these different areas. Which we basically did, again, to attract attention to nuclear, to the peaceful uses applications, and ideally to get more money for all the great projects. So, thanks, Erica. Great to remind. Yeah, we should have brought our whole bookmarks.
You developed it. Mission?
We did well. We had to, you know, get some technical help obviously, yeah, to do it, and but we partnered with the agency and got the information about that helped us make it more specific and document programs that we funded. Oh yeah, you just download it.
Well,
yeah,
on
Apple and Android.
Especially young female scientists.
Okay, that's fantastic because, you know, I tell you, when I was in Southeast Asia in the fall, and it was largely focused on promoting technical cooperation and nuclear applications, and, you know, both interchanging with governments and visiting nuclear labs and projects and stuff. So it was really great to see. For example, the Malaysian head of a female from one of their labs, I run into now an agency for proposals. So lots of great women out there in Southeast Asia and around the world. That's
very
fantastic.
Good. Because normally when people hear nuclear, they immediately think of the power applications. But there
exactly.
are so many non-power applications which need to be brought out to the public much more because here nuclear techniques can really make a change. Public awareness is just not.
They really have no idea, and they think of it as something sort of scary. They have no idea that nuclear medicine is radiation. I mean, who doesn't, you know, X-rays, mammograms.
Right.
I mean, it's nuclear, but people don't think about that.
Would you allow me just one last question?
Sure.
Last question.
Sure.
We'll try to get a photo.
Yes, please. Kennedy. I'm just curious to know.
Sorry.
Is this coincidence? Or
no relation. Although I was in Tokyo I was going to Fukushima Daiichi, the plant, but did lots of great nuclear applications there too. And so we wanted to do sort of a Twitter, you know, the two tweeting Ambassador Kennedys. She was out of the country and I was there, so I was really disappointed. But no actual relations other than that were at least temporarily
curiosity.
The same line of business. So anyhow.
Once again, a big, big thank you from all of us.
Well,
before we release it, first let's make a group photo and then we have a small something for you.
Giving me a fabulous lunch.
So are you on the stairs?
Yeah,
I think on the stairs might be best.
Oh,
I don't fall down.
Yeah. totally. And also we have developed.
Yeah, I'll come in, but I want to, I'll cut a photo out of the video. Can you all see that you can look into this camera too when it, for a few minutes?
Oh, you got to do one with my phone so I can tweet it.
Okay. Alright, 1, 2, 3. 1, 2, 3. Alright. And 1, 2, 3. 1, 2, 3. And now your phone is?
It's in my purse. If you grab my phone, I'm so sorry. I should have thought about this.
No, this is yours.
Bless you. Thank you.
That's my
great day. Okay. Thank you so much.
You're welcome.
Okay. All
right.
Right on.
Don't wait, it's a private phone.
All right. 1, 2, 3. 1, 2, 3. Okay.
All right. Thank you. Okay. Oh my God. Oh.
If you had joined us there, I could have taken a. I mean, I'm filming, you know?
Oh my God! Oh, that's a comment.
You're in the video, anyway.
Oh,
well.
Great! Oh my God! Thank you!
Yeah.
My pleasure!
Thank you guys. This is so much fun.